So today we'll be carrying forward with our last discussion on market structures. And last time we had studied about the determinants of market structure. And today we will further understand much more neatly and in categories form what are the different types of market structures and what are their characteristics and how does a particular market structure may impact the prices of a particular product sold in that kind of market structure, and how does it impact the customers, and how does it impact the new entrants into that kind of market. So these are all the things that we would be discussing in today's lecture. But before I start, let us have a brief recap. So what is the reason that we study market structure? What do you recall from our last lecture?
Ma'am, to understand the nature of competition.
And how knowing the nature of the competition is vital? Why is it vital?
Because if we know the market competition or the nature of the competition, we'll be able to properly place our product in the market.
Okay. And?
And do it proper pricing.
Proper pricing. And what about the long-term and short-term strategic planning that is related to a product? How is market structure important in that case? Okay, so knowing about brief about the market structure and its major players, which you will be later studying as your competitors, so it helps us to understand what their strategies is and what is the ideal customer profile. And based on, you know, these two aspects, you can take decisions as both on in the short term and in the long term about the product launching, specific feature of your products and other aspects. So we had also studied about the determinants of market structure. So do you recall the determinants of market structure?
Ma'am, number and nature of sellers.
Number and nature of sellers. Similarly, number and nature of buyers. Yeah.
The nature of product.
The nature of product.
And economy of scales.
Economies of scale and the condition of entry and exit into the market. So having studied the, the determinants of market structure, we had understood that markets can differ based on all these determinants. And finally, we had stopped at this particular slide. So in today's lecture, we will be discussing about in detail these market structures and what are their characteristics and some of these examples and the discussions on that. So is my slide visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So first, let us talk about the perfect market competition. Perfect market competition, or perfect competition market as the name implies, it means that the number of buyers and sellers is very large in that particular market. And when I use the word market, please be assured that market is any place where any buying or selling or any transaction of like this is getting on or is getting conducted. It's not necessarily restricted to a particular physical market, but it can be an online market, internet market, or market which is based on exchanging correspondences and mails and things like that. So in a perfect competition market, the number of buyers and sellers is extremely large and they are engaged in buying and selling a homogeneous product. So what do you think is the meaning of homogeneous product? What is a homogeneous product?
Ma'am, that stands itself like there aren't any other similar products?
Can you give an example, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Go on.
Ma'am, vegetables?
Vegetables?
Yes. No, vegetables aren't the option.
Fruits and vegetables are one of the products in homogeneous product market.
Ma'am, because the other sellers all have the same thing to sell as customers, yeah. Just have same choice which we want to go.
Correct. So, as in the example of vegetable markets, there are homogeneous products, vegetables and fruits. There is no product differentiation in them, and that is why they qualify as a perfect competition market. So naturally, when there is no product differentiation and they are all selling the same products, there is a freedom of entry and exit from the market or from the industry. Now, let us think for a moment. When there are n number of buyers and sellers, in fact, sellers who are selling the homogeneous product, and so why do you think when you go to a grocery market or a sabzi mandi, why do you think that you find shopkeepers who are selling the similar vegetables, but even then their stall is there? I mean, if a new entrant wants to come and he already knows or she already knows that there are a bunch of people who are selling exactly the same items that she's going to sell in the market, what do you think she thinks when she's entering into the market? Why doesn't she feel discouraged when there are already so many sellers of that particular product? There is higher amount of demand, yes. And so I think what is the nature of competition when it comes to selling vegetables? If you look at the pricing of vegetables, what do you think, who determines the pricing of vegetables in a particular grocery market?
The person who sells the vegetables, the one who's able to attract more attraction gets the more customer.
But so you mean to say it's not getting influenced by his or her fellow sellers?
Ma'am, it does get influenced by fellow sellers.
How?
In many markets, there's this limit that even if you want to sell below, you can't, because then others selling at the same place could target you. Like it's like an unofficial union that decides that no one is allowed to sell below this or above this.
Also, because there is large number of buyers and sellers, basically sellers, so there is no particular monopoly of any seller to establish the price of a particular commodity, unless,
for example, like when Jio came, the prices of Netwheel,
yeah,
like went totally down, right? But no one can do something like this in the vegetable market, because it's pretty much already set, especially in local vegetable market. No one can come and say, I have so many free tomatoes, I'll give them for free. If you are in that market, then you will have to sell them at the same price as others tomato sellers are selling.
If not same, almost similar. But why is it that happens that if you browse the market for some time, then you always end up also finding some seller who is selling the commodity at a reduced price than the ones sitting at the beginning of the market?
Ma'am, but different sellers, we can bargain with them differently. Like, we can negotiate them with pricing.
And even the quality of the thing and that material also matters.
It does matter.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
And the vendor who has more number of vegetables will be able to give it for a lesser price.
Absolutely, absolutely. So in the markets, there are sellers who are not willing to negotiate their price or decrease the price of the commodity. Perhaps they say that the quality of vegetable that you are getting at their shop, you will not get in any other shops. And that could also be the reason that sometimes they end up fixing a price slightly higher than the similar products in the market, but it's not always that high. The another thing, characteristics of perfect market competition is that profit maximization is the goal. So there is no restriction on, you know, any of the sellers, basically, because there are many players in the market, and most probably they are trying to maximize their individual gain. So it's not always that a particular union will be there to monitor and scrutinize their prices, because ultimately it is, even though it's not decided individually, it is influenced by the market players in that particular market. However, profit maximization remains the goal of these players. And these people also have a perfect knowledge of market conditions, because they know what kind of demand is there, and they are not only aware of what they are selling, but also what their competitors are selling. And based on that kind of study, again, they can introduce some other products in the market, so that will provide them an edge over others, especially when it comes to homogeneous products. For a very simple example, if you happen to live in a town or a tier 3 kind of city, and there are local vegetable markets, so the variety over there is not much. However, if there is a vegetable seller who has much more variety of vegetables and fruits as compared to the others, then he or she will definitely have an upper hand in setting the prices of the products. So this is what a perfect competition market is. Any questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So as we had discussed, agricultural market is one of the kinds of a perfect competition market. When it comes to mobile manufacturing, what do you think is the kind of market of mobile manufacturing? Mobile handsets manufacturing. So does it qualify as a perfect competition market?
The number of sellers are very high. That's why there is competition among each other.
But ma'am, there is no absence of artificial restrictions.
Yeah.
Because people add on many things to on the handset just to make it to have edge over the market. So it cannot qualify as a perfect competition market.
And what about the homogeneous requirement of the product?
It depends on the consumer. No, if a person is photographer, he'll need for for the purpose of photography to just take it out his cell phone and shoot. Or it's for a business person, then he might be needing to have some documents on it.
Okay, so the question I was asking was that mobile ma'am, handsets, although
ma'am, in India, mostly budget centric smartphones are only sold if it's in percentage. Like in between 10 to 20,000 cost, because nowadays all companies are selling their phone in that price range with maximum features and bringing new technologies.
Okay, and so the point you are trying to make is,
I'm like I am telling about that phone, like many new companies are also coming, which are also making this budget centering smartphones only, not high end smartphone like 50,000 rupees smartphone or all.
Yeah. So perhaps they have studied the Indian market and the people and their purchasing power parity, and based on that they have come up with a new product for the Indian people in the market. So that is one thing about perfect competition market. So knowing about perfect competition market is vital among the other type of five markets, because look, go back to your innovation projects and then think about what kind of competition is there when you think about the projects and the products that you had proposed in your innovation project. coming to the monopoly market, I think most of you are very much familiar with monopoly market. There is, ideally, there is only one seller of the product which with barriers to entry of others. Now, when we talk about barriers to entry of others, what do you think could act as barriers for entry to other people in that same product segment? And you can answer this question if you have watched the DBS documentary on diamonds. So when there is only one seller of the product and others have a difficulty entering into the market, what is the reason behind that barrier and that difficulty? Because that's a pretty good advantage that, you know, you are the only one in the market and others are finding it difficult to enter into the market. So you would ideally want to be in that kind of situation.
Sir, ma'am, maybe he's giving much more to his customers than other can do to him, give to these customers.
So maybe he or the company is giving more to the customers than the other can.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you think of an example to substantiate what you said?
Ma'am means some add-on features and some add-on offers, like again the Jio usually starting it gives phones with the same and about 3 months of data. Of course he is giving the same by his own cost, but he knows that it is a long-term investment and in future these all that I have invested will come back. But others who don't have the debt financially strong structure, then they will not give that much to the customers and definitely they will not come to the market.
Right. So you have explained really well. However, when you talk about add-ons or other features, I think it's the main product that always makes or breaks the reality of monopoly in the market. And then add-ons could be other aspects which actually strengthen the monopoly in the market. And the product has close to no substitutes when it comes to monopoly market. So, sorry. So it is not ideally possible to have a monopoly market, even though Jio has a substantial amount of users in Indian market. But if you look at the non-regular users of Jio, they are much more high as compared to Bharti Airtel or Vodafone Idea. Now, the advantage of being a monopoly in the market is that you can influence the price of a product. And if people really need that product, they will have to shell out money from their pockets to buy your product. So the company is actually the price maker. It's not a price taker. Whereas in the perfect competition, the sellers are price takers. They're not price makers. Is this distinction clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So how many of you had watched the documentary or read the article on diamonds that I had recommended last time? It was a 25-minute documentary. Anyone? No one? Okay, so I was asking if anyone has watched the documentary on diamonds I had suggested the last time.
Not yet, ma'am.
Okay, so if you watch that documentary, I think you all must watch the documentary if possible after today's lecture, because in that documentary it is explained that how De Beers became a monopoly in the diamonds market all over the world. So what they did was that not only they had lots of diamonds with themselves, but they also started controlling the supply of diamonds from other parts of the world. And in the other parts of the world, whoever were selling diamonds, they started buying those diamonds also. So in this way, they developed their own reserve of diamonds, and they had the maximum reserves of diamonds as compared to other people during that time. So they were able to control the sale of the diamonds during that time, and that is how they were able to become the monopoly in that market. Even what, although they had to crash after some time, but De Beers had its own manual about how to retain customers and how to continue to be the market king. So that is why I strongly encourage you to go and watch the documentary, because then it will be easier to relate to the lectures in this series. The third type of competition is the monopolistic competition. As we had discussed the last time, when we are dealing with selling of differentiated products, directly comes the monopolistic competition. In such type of market, there is a competition among a large number of sellers producing close to but not perfect substitutes for each other. So there are obviously there are large number of sellers and there are large number of buyers. There is product differentiation. So when we talk about product differentiation, what do you think goes into the minds of sellers who are trying to introduce their products in a monopolistic competition? What do you think they have to process, and how do they have to gather the information if they are introducing a differentiated product of a similar product in the market? What is it that they have to think? Because it is really a gamble, it's a big risk to sell a product in the market such that there are already similar products of that kind in the market. So what is it that is the most crucial aspect that a new entrant must think when he or she enters into monopolistic competition?
Ma'am, so in starting, he or she may said to the customers that our product is pure to others, that somehow comparison must be there.
Yeah, so that could be one of the marketing strategies for the new product. That is what new entrants often use, marketing and advertisement of the nature of their product. And but you see, direct comparison with other products in the market is not generally allowed when it comes to marketing. So you cannot promote your product by saying that it is better than the existing product by naming a particular brand. You can do a research in general and tell to the customers, but taking a name is strictly prohibited when it comes to advertisement or marketing your product.
Ma'am, I can do a research on asking the customers what they think of the present products available to them, and what they think is missing, or what unique they want with it. And I can try to make that unique thing or add more to the product and sell it, saying it is my product.
Correct. So what you talk about, Sarvesh, is need assessment of the customers who are already using a similar product that you are trying to introduce into the market. And that brings us to a very important aspect in entrepreneurship or business. For some reasons, I rather use the word vision than business or entrepreneurship, because it's basically your vision that you are trying to sell to the people. And depending on that vision, lots of decisions are made. So don't just think of your company or your project or your innovation or entrepreneurship project. Think of it, whatever you're trying to do, as your vision. So to bring your vision to fruition, you need to understand customers. And because customers are your Bible when it comes to both long-term and short-term profits in the market. So when it comes to monopolistic competition and introducing differentiated products, if you read the history of how different products have been introduced in the market, then there is always a need assessment that has been done in the market. And the need, for example, although the example does not suit here for monopolistic competition, but think about cash on delivery. Cash on delivery is the only mechanism by which people pay to Amazon in India. Why do you think Amazon introduced cash on delivery in India?
Ma'am, because Indians did not have the trust that they would buy something on the internet, so they would at the end get that same product at the home delivered if the people did.
So that means they actually did this study before introducing COD in Indian market. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So the role of research in entrepreneurship cannot be overstated. Research is extremely important, and the better you know your customers inside and out, and the more you talk to them, and not only in survey forms but also in interview forms using qualitative surveys. In fact, we will be talking about these segments in our future lectures. So then it gets better, and sometimes, you know, customers themselves don't know what they need. That also happens. And a new company comes up which makes people aware that perhaps this is what they need. And this is what has happened in American pharmaceutical markets, sadly. So if you know about lots of drugs used for psychological well-being and mental health, there have been companies mushrooming in United States of America which have convinced people of certain kinds of mental disorders and diseases which exist, and based on that they have created their own drugs. So very smartly they created a market because they convinced people of these kind of diseases, and then they started selling their medications. So that is also one aspect of introducing product into the market. And there are always unscrupulous practices also which are done to introduce particular products in the markets. So that kind of customer relationship is very important for the long-term growth of any company. So when we talk about product differentiation, you just do not go into a market and introduce a product differentiated in some manner. What if your product is excellent and it's differentiated, but the customer just does not feel the need of it? Then all the hard work and the investment of time and human resources that you have done in creation of that product sadly comes down to nothing. That is why it's always very important to get to know your customers before you actually try to sell something to them. So in monopolistic competition, differentiation can be based on quality, design, color, style, or any other aspects. Now, when it comes to the pricing of differentiated products, what do you think influences or determines the pricing of the differentiated products in a monopolistic market? They're selling almost the same kind of thing. Then how do they decide the price? So think of it like buying milk packets. In India, there are many companies which are selling packaged milk, and the prices vary. So what do you think could be the factors that determine the varying prices of differentiated products?
Some targeted customers. What is the goal of the company? Are they focusing on the group of people whose average income is literally below, or the people who have higher income?
Okay, so you feel that based on the income segment of the customers,
yeah,
the product pricing can be determined?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And maybe cost of production of that product could also determine the final selling price of that product, and how much has gone into producing that product.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Because, ma'am, actually, ma'am, once what experience I had, I went to a Nike factory outlet, and I asked him who produces it, and he says that the producer, the one who manufactures the shoes for Adidas, Nike, and all other sneakers is the same. But the only the pricing difference is because of the marketing structure, and each and every shoe is made just for amount of 50 rupees, but we sell it at 8,000.
Oh, wow. That is quite a new insight to me as well. So talking about Nike and big showrooms, when you go to brand factory outlets or wholesale shops, why do you think they price their products a bit lower than as you see in the malls or other places?
Ma'am, so that we buy more of their stuff.
Is that the only reason?
Ma'am, I think so. Like they have offers like buy three, get six to sell their products.
Ma'am, usually in wholesale, that thing comes from the manufacturer to the wholesaler. Then he has, means he usually have less prices because that final retailer also had to pay for the transport and usually get increase in that price for his benefits.
Right. So when it comes to wholesale for sellers, I think their margin for loss is a bit more as compared to individual sellers. Last time we had talked about economies of scale also. So as a company grows over the period of time, I think it can afford its per unit cost decreases, as a result of which, you know, the per unit cost of the item that they are selling tends to decrease, and that is why perhaps they can afford to have lower prices at these places. And moreover, as you said, they want the customers to buy more also. That could also be one of the reasons. In monopolistic competition, there is freedom of entry and exit of firms. So there are many firms that can enter into the market and many which can exit. Now, we already discussed about the entry of firms into the market. What could be the situations in which a particular seller decides to exit from such kind of monopolistic competition market or a perfect competition market? What could be the reason behind the decision to exit the market?
Ma'am, not enough profit?
Yes. And
maybe.
Go on.
Ma'am, he might even lose a part of money as the market grows smaller. Sometimes it happens. Like I had a personal experience. My father's company went down because
of it. Okay. So what exactly he had led to the
company? And after the GST and these corona times, it had to go down.
Okay. So when we talk about exiting from the market, think about so many other companies which are operating online, but they had to exit from the market because of, sometimes it's about not only about not making profit, but because logistics are not there because of the market restrictions, the transportation restrictions. There is restriction on traveling, and because of that, their products cannot be transported from one place to another. And if they are not able to arrive at a solution to solve this kind of hurdle, then they will have to make a tough decision of exiting of firms. In fact, there are so many founders of startups who are operating quite well before the COVID time. But after the COVID, they have started looking for alternative jobs. But they have not forgotten their companies. But because they still have to raise the capital for their firms and startups, they have to look out for the alternative jobs. So COVID as a time is a very opportune time to understand, you know, if you are trying to launch your own product into the market in the near future, you must be aware of how market can change due to external events. And ultimately, everything in the world is interconnected. I always believe that when we talk about business, we are not only talking about economics, we're not talking about only technology, because any solution and any problem is a complex interrelated relationship between multiple things. And generally, we tend to avoid the importance of sociology and anthropology and ethnographic studies also, but it is always important to remember, even psychology for that matter, that problems in real world cannot be neatly categorized into mathematical problems or technological problems. They are always very intricately related, and solutions to real world problems are not at all easy and not at all linear in manner. So that is important to remember, and when you can understand that, then it becomes easier to understand why some firms decide to exit the market. Sometimes they are literally thrown off from the market because people have stopped buying their products totally. So think about how the iPod had come into the market. It was not the first MP3 player or music player during that time, but still it became so famous. What was it that the Steve Jobs did differently that led to the success of the iPod?
And the user interaction with the product.
What kind of interaction? The ease of using that device?
Yes, ma'am. And the amount of storage that iPod had.
Okay.
And ma'am, before the iPods, we had Walkmans for portable use, and they couldn't store that much songs much iPod did.
Correct. So essentially, Steve Jobs' words, the existing market MP3 players were all crap because they were not capturing the experience of listening to music by people, and the storage was limited, and they were sometimes loaded into hard disk and all, and that was stealing the experience of people. Now think about JioFi. Now JioFi is certainly a revolutionary product in the Indian market. What could have led to the introduction of JioFi?
JioFi actually let the users use their internet for free 100 GB per month in the initial few months. Like we had it for 7 months.
But I'm asking you to think about what could have been the thought behind the creation of something called as JioFi.
Like, users will get to know how they can use the internet in an efficient way. Like now we all watch all the streams in HD rather than that 480, 420, whatever be. So we are getting used to using a lot of internet. That's what they actually wanted. To create a market.
Okay, so they must have
thought that people who are actually aware don't want to use their mobile phones to supply hotspots to other members in the family. And so they made.
Right. And one thing with mobile hotspot was that since there are other apps running in the background, the kind of speed that you may want for YouTube may not be that great. But when you designate a particular device for mobile internet, then there are better speed also for the internet. Then look at the different plans also of JioFi. If you look at the different plans of JioFi, there also a lot of thinking and strategy making has gone into place. And that directly comes from understanding the usage of the internet of the customers and also what they need. And especially in the COVID times, I think people's usage of internet has increased considerably. And because of that, I think there's a controversy that is going on that while many people are dying because of COVID, few companies are making profit. So it directly,
Are we talking about JioFi or JioFiber?
Sorry, I'm actually told about
JioFi. JioFi has the same plans as the phone.
JioFi.
So one thing that comes into picture is, if you know about Karl Marx, capitalism, capitalistic society versus socialist society is one of the raging debates when it comes to business. And that is also one thing that you should be very careful about when you are trying to introduce a product into the market, because ultimately when we talk about the ethics of the market, these things become really very important. Now coming to the fourth type of market structure, oligopoly. It is a market situation in which there are few firms selling homogeneous or differentiated products. And it is difficult to pinpoint the number of firms in competition among the few. So there are mostly 2, 3, or 4 firms, but not more. And so, for example, the examples for oligopoly could be producers of aluminium, cement, steel, copper, zinc. And for these, there are both government sector companies and private sector companies as well. And producers of consumer goods such as automobiles, TV, refrigerators, the famous companies also qualify as oligopolies in the market. So, but this kind of market is not very common, but it is quite seen for products such as expressed as before. But when it comes to the government level, like Hindalco or Nalco, then they are generally considered as not oligopolies, but monopolies sometimes, because these are the ones which are responsible for providing aluminium and all these kind of metals for the development of structures in Indian markets. So in Indian market, I'm not sure if I know of an example of oligopoly, but in general, these could qualify as examples for oligopoly market structures. In line with this, the last type of market structure is the duopoly. It's a special case of oligopoly in which there are only two sellers. Now, when it comes to two sellers, either, you know, the activities of one seller can influence the decisions of others if the other is willing to take the notice of what the first seller is doing. If, however, this particular seller decides to operate in an independent manner, then he or she may go on their way to make their own decisions. So it is always a choice of the seller in this particular kind of market structure if they want to follow or if they want to be aware of what the other seller is doing. So a seller may assume that his rival is unaffected by what he does, which is not generally the case. So in that case, he takes only his own direct influence on the price. However, sometimes he may also want to see the indirect influence on its price based on the other seller. And in that case, a sort of relationship exists between these two kind of sellers. So few examples of duopolies in Indian market are Swiggy and Zomato, Amazon and Flipkart, Uber, Ola and Visa, MasterCard. So when we talk about duopolies in Indian market, what do you think could determine which one is more successful? Especially when it comes to duopolies, I think that is a advantage to the companies. So which one is more successful, Swiggy or Zomato, according to you?
Zomato.
So why do you think Zomato is more successful?
And because it offers, it gives cheap delivery, the prices of deliveries are cheap in Zomato. Whereas okay. Also, it also shows reviews of the restaurants.
Okay, so then it depends on how you are categorizing and quantifying the word success when it comes to duopolies in Indian market. So according to you, it is based on the customer reviews of that particular product?
Yes,
ma'am. Of the service?
Yes, ma'am.
And when it comes to Amazon and Flipkart, who is emerging as the clear winner? Why?
Ma'am, Amazon.
But just think for a moment that Flipkart is a homegrown company and started by Indian founders, and now it is being funded by Walmart also. So what is it that, where is Amazon? And personally, I think most of us are loyal customers of Amazon. What is it that has led us to bestow such deep amount of trust on Amazon?
Amazon provides many features like Amazon Video, music, and other things too.
So it is slowly creating ecosystem.
Yes, basically it's like a big brand name, so we automatically think of it before. Especially for those people who only care about getting one product or two products.
True. And when we talk about Amazon, think of how it started. It started as a bookseller, online bookseller.
Yes, ma'am.
And slowly, slowly, if you must read about the history of Amazon and how Jeff Bezos actually started it with 250 million points from his father. And it actually branded itself as the largest bookseller online. And that time, Barnes & Noble actually sued Amazon for claiming itself to be something that it is not. But Amazon persisted. And then slowly, it expanded its product range to something that we now see today. So it is worth reading about how Amazon came to be as we know today and how it continues to scale up as well. So these are few duopolies in the Indian market. So now that we know about the kind of market structures, next time when we come across a product or come across a controversy in the Financial Times or Business Insider, we may be able to have a bit of perspective of what is happening in this particular case and why it's happening. So this is the essential reading for the week. This is a Harvard Business Review article on how competitive forces shape strategy. And the second video is on sustainable competitive advantage. You see, in business, it's not just sufficient to have competitive advantage. Ideally, you need competitive advantage which is sustainable over the period of time, such that no matter what changes in the market ecosystem or what unexpected situation arise, your product continues to sell higher among the people. And that is what is called as the sustainable competitive advantage. So please watch this video also. And that brings me to a group assignment for all of you. So this group assignment will be based on innovation projects. So go back to your innovation projects and then try to answer these questions. Who are the customers of your product? Basically, who are the buyers? And why do you think they are the buyers? So you just do not have to specify who are the buyers, but why do you think they are the buyers? And I might change the word limit, might increase it, because I feel reasoning might demand much more to explain. Then who are the other sellers of the same product in the market? And it might so happen that currently there are no sellers for your particular product. In that case, you will have to perhaps search in the international market, because most of the times what we are thinking has already been thought, at least by someone. So try to identify the sellers or the similar people who are involved in the business that you are proposing, and try to identify them and justify that why do you think they are the sellers. What is the nature of your product? What is the nature of your product, and is it differentiated from others in existing market? So look at the solution that you are trying to sell, or look at the product that you are trying to sell in the market. And based on the five types of market structures that we have studied, what is the nature of your product? Is it a product which has never been launched before, or is it a solution, such solution which already exists in the market, but you are introducing a differentiated form of the solution? And for what you are proposing to introduce into the market, what kind of market structure exists? So if you enter into the market tomorrow, what kind of competition will you be experiencing? Will it be perfect competition, monopolistic, oligopoly, duopoly, or monopoly, if you're targeting a monopoly? So that you need to identify and explain with proper reasoning and logic that why do you think this particular market competition applies to the product that you have proposed. And lastly, which are the current market players in India or globally which provide the same and differentiated solution as yours? So this is the group assignment which pertains to market structures. Are there any questions regarding the assignment? Are you facing any difficulties in doing the assignment during the current times?
Let me react.
if anyone is facing any kind of problem in finishing the